and he's going to speak about point of regard from eye
such in a way, that it feels real, and it's really convincing, and I absolutely fell in love with it as soon as I tried it. And one of the applications which I use quite a bit is called Refax Theater. Now this is a virtual theater where you can log in online and go to a theater and see other people with their avatars on, wearing their own Oculus Rift, and even move your hands around and see their hands moving around. And this is actually me, as a guest, as a talk, on a talk show in Refax Theater, and this is me explaining this exact work to the other guests on the show and the audience in the background. So it's really interesting because there's a lot of expression there, but there's one thing that I noticed, and that was everybody's eyes were dead forward the whole time. It doesn't matter where that head was looking, it's always dead forward. They blinked occasionally, but otherwise it was kind of creepy. And I figure as soon as you have the eyes in there, if you can control the eyes, it suddenly becomes a person and not some weird mannequin somebody's controlling from like a marionette. So I became interested in seeing what kind of things you can do with eye tracking in VR. There's a whole bunch of other applications, like active rendering. You don't have to render the entire scene in full detail, you just render where the person looking and save a bunch of computation time. Things like that. So that's what led me to this research. So in this talk I'm gonna talk about my research goal. And I'm going to talk about general previous results about virtual environments and eye tracking within them. And then I'll talk about my method, which is intersection of hypothesis surfaces. And I'll show you a simulation of my method working with a virtual pair of eyes. And then I'll talk about limitations and what I want to do next. So, eye tracking, if you're unfamiliar with it, what you want to do is figure out the point of regard. And the point of regard is the point where your eyes are focused. The human eyes only ever look at one point at a time. This is because at the back, the cells at the back of the eye that sense light can only detect height detail in a small region at the back of the eye called the fovea. And so you move your eye to detect detail. You move in around what's called a saccade, and it's a rapid movement. Hundreds of degrees a second, and then you stop and you fixate, you get information, you move again. You don't get any information during a saccade. And because we have two eyes, and we live in a 3D world, our eyes also converge. So that if you're looking at a near object, they'll swivel inwards to point and unite the two regions of the fovea, so you see high detail. Generally, you do this by watching your eyes with the camera, and then looking where the pupil is, and looking at where a reflection is on the pupil. To detect where the eye is looking on, say, a 2D screen. Usually it's just a 2D screen. And the key limitations to that is that you get high noise levels because the eye is small and it's difficult to track. And you need to recalibrate. So you need to prompt the user to say, your calibration is off, we need to recalibrate. Look at this point, look at this point, look at this point, and then continue what you're doing. So what I wanted to do is get rid of that process where you ask the user to look at these points. I want to do that automatically. And I just wanted to increase the reliability of the eye tracking, so reduce the amount of noise that's put in the pattern. And the trick to doing this is using virtual environments. So when you render a virtual environment, whether it's a 2D one or whether you're in a stereoscopic environment with a head-mounted display, you know where all the geometry is in the world. So you need to do this, otherwise you can't render it. So since your eyes must focus on the geometry in the world to see it, you therefore have basically a set of hypotheses the way the user is looking. They can't be, they won't be looking in mid-air, as in a 3D sense. They'll always be looking at a surface. So they're looking at the floor or chairs or something at infinity perhaps. So I want to use that information to get rid of the user-prompted calibration procedure. So some background in 2D eye tracking noise reduction first of all. So this is in virtual environments. There's a procedure called gaze object mapping, where instead of trying to get the precise point of regard, you take your approximate point of regard, which you've measured, and then your end goal is to just figure out which object in the virtual scene, because you have a list of objects that you've rendered, which object the user is looking at. And that actually reduces, there's a few nice probabilistic ways to do that. And it reduces the noise significantly. Of course, you don't get as much information, but it's still quite useful. And the result that I wanted to build on, which I did build on, is by Mentio et al. And they proposed gaze-driven object tracking. And in this scenario, in this technique, they scatter hypotheses, these points, around the scene, and they also place them on every object. So this circle, so one, the dragon has a couple, and you compare the point of regard on a 2D surface, because it's just a 2D screen, you measure their eye velocity, and you measure their eye position, and you compare it to each hypothesis. So when this ball is moving around in a circle, it's really easy to judge that because you can tell their eyes are moving around with it. And it, while it adds a bit of latency, it reduces noise. So I wanted to take this and generalize it to a stereoscopic environment, where it also had depth measurements. And that leads me to my method that I built. So we want to use the depth, because your eyes are merged, we can actually model it, instead of modeling the point of regard as a single point on a 2D screen, we model it as a 3D point. It's quite simple. And since the point of regard always lies on a visible surface, we can eliminate any hypotheses which aren't on the surface. If we just randomly distribute hypotheses around the room right now, we can get rid of the ones that are floating in the air, because people don't look in the middle of the air, they look at surfaces. So first we need a bit of math. Formalize the way we're going to transform and manipulate these hypotheses. So, given a point of green space, on x, y, z, there's a unique set of angles which I call the I angles, which are simply the elevation and bearing from each eye. So you have theta L is the bearing from the left eye, theta phi L is the elevation from the left eye. So these are these angles here, this is the right eye. And so we get a one-to-one mapping from 3D space to eye angles. If you want to go the other way, you need to use an approximation, assuming that there is a point of regard represented. So if you have a set of eye angles, you cast two rays, and approximate, assume that they do represent a point of regard with maybe a bit of noise, and then basically project the two lines onto each other to get an approximation of a 3D point of regard. So then, now, instead of using absolute eye measurements, if we can just measure the velocity of the eye, the rotational velocity of both eyes, then we get delta theta delta phi in each eye. And to update the hypothesis, we convert it to eye angles, add in the change, and then convert it back approximately to a 3D point of regard. And then we can, by doing that, we're moving hypotheses around the circuit, around the scene, and any sort of points that aren't on the surface, we can discover. So, then the key observation is the point of regard has to be the intersection of the scene geometry repeatedly transformed by the measured eye movements. And so we'll go through an example. So this is the scene of the standard bunny. And suppose we move our eyes from here to the nose to look in here. Then initially, we don't know where the user is looking. So everything's a hypothesis, could be anywhere on the bunny. Then the user moves their eyes and did the transformation to every point on the body, and the body moves down here. And then we do the intersection with the original surface, which we must still be looking at a point on the surface. Because the scene hasn't changed, just our hypothesis set. So we take the intersection of that green body, which is our hypothesis set, the scene is still there. And the scene is just transparent here, just a demonstration. And you can see that the final point of the guide is still within this intersection. Of course, the intersection here has been taken with a bit of thickness just to demonstrate what's from the other side. That demonstrates the idea behind the process. It's important to note that this transformation is not linear at all. So this is just quadrilateral. If you view it from this camera here, with your eyes inside it, and you move your eyes from between those two points, then the hypothesis set will be transformed into this. And obviously it's not a plane anymore. It's quite warped, but it is still a two-dimensional monopole. So when you do the intersection, you'll get a one-dimensional monopole, and then you transform that one-dimensional monopole the next time over, do another intersection, you get a point, or a zero-dimensional monopole at least, and you have an approximation of the point of the guard. So this is the sort of formal formalization of the process, but it doesn't really work for a computer if you want to model it as a mesh. At least that seemed like a hard way to go about it. So instead of modeling as a mesh and doing intersections of like Boolean operations, I decided to go with a particle filter style approach. So I developed a variant on the Bayesian particle filter, and I call it the particle induction filter, because it slowly deduces which particles remain in the set. So we initialize them randomly over the scene, then we update them according to the eye, measured eye movements, as discussed. And then we compare each particle to the depth buffer that's behind it. So the reason we're using the depth buffer is that it's a very cheap option. It's always there when you're rendering, if you know anything about the graphics. Just take a photo of the depth. And then the particles decay on the grade dependent on how much they disagree with the depth buffer. So now I will go to my live demonstration. So here we have a bunch of targets, and they are orbiting around just a central target, just an arbitrary movement that I've called it. And the user, so the virtual user, can choose to look at any of the targets, and their true point of regard is indicated by the intersection of the red lines that go across the screen. And you can see the gray represents the hypotheses in the particle filter, and the white is the weighted average. And so you might have seen it start, if I restart it, you'll catch the large distribution of particles, and then it slowly thins out, or quickly thins out, until it finds the correct hypothesis. And so you can see that the particles such as noise, this is including some Gaussian noise in the measurement, and you can counteract that by generating particles around, and sending some sort of particle filter. So here's that slowed down, basically. You have the initial particles, and after 0.5 seconds, the transformation moves most of the particles so that they move away from the surface, and then they are discarded as bad hypotheses. And then after 5 seconds, you end up with full convergence. This is a particularly bad case because there was another secondary group of particles which was not eliminated until quite late. So the limitations in this are, you need a lot of particles if you're going to deal with noise. So the amount of noise I had there was not a lot, and I was running at 60 frames a second, which is about the limit we want for virtual reality. So to get past that, I need more particles to get past the noise. So I want to implement a GPU parallelization. So you do all of the particle updates and resample them, and you have them, they're not dependent on each other. So if I can parallelize that, I can get as many particles as and theoretically overcome most noise limitations. And also the depth buffer is, while it's cheap, it is discontinuous, which means suppose there was a particle hypothesis near the correct target that I was looking at in that simulation, it will be discarded because the depth buffer behind it is at infinity or at minus 10, at 10 meters per second. That's just the case in that simulation. So I want to either filter the depth buffer, just sort of a Gaussian blur filter, or do a more complicated geometry approach where I actually project to the closest surface. In conclusion, my method deduces an absolute point of regard from only eye velocity measurements without having to perform user calibration. And the system will automatically recalibrate itself if it loses track. And my next step is to apply it to real data. So I've tried some electroocularography, which is a way to measure movements of the eye, but it's generally a relative measurement. And us is local computer-based vision measurements. Essentially, I want to put an optical mouse on somebody's eye, because you can do like local slam and then just get a velocity of the eye from that and see what I can do with that. So thank you.
Yeah, from your demo, it seemed like you had the position moving smoothly.
Yes.
But in fact, normal eye movements are kind of saccades.
They are saccades, but when you fixate, so what you're talking about is actually called a smooth pursuit.
Yeah.
So if you watch your finger, you can smoothly pursue your finger. Because it's a moving object. If there's no moving object, then you can't smoothly, you can smoothly pursue an object.
So it may be smooth for a while.
And then you might saccade to the next object, and then you might saccade back to another one.
Yeah.
So another problem is detecting when a fixation's happened. Usually it's not too hard, because fixations are very fast.
Mm-hmm.
So even if you're tracking a moving object, it's usually much slower than saccades, so you just put a cut off it, velocity. But some objects, if you get an object moving fast enough, it can be set as, oh, it's a saccade, say anything about the hypotheses right now. But that's generally a lot of the case.
Yeah. I'm sure you're aware of the study in robotics, they call it the kidnapped robot problem. Like, if all the
batteries
are suddenly, it means maybe the robot can switch off and move to other places.
Yes, that's right. Yes.
How long does it take to move within the eye or what kind of miles and some of
that? That is something I have to investigate. It's just an idea that I've had. Essentially, it would be pretty safe, I think. You wouldn't want to use a laser mouse, of course, but that's requiring quite a lot. What you need is to illuminate the eye and get a camera nice and close so we can get just that nice patch so we can do local optical flow and determine what the velocity of the eye is at any point in time.
So it's too difficult to use
just a camera.
Having mounted eye tracking system. Would it be easier to do it this way?
It does work. I think my system will improve the results from that as well. Because you still have to calibrate it that way. Especially when it's end-mounted, you bump it a bit and you have to recalibrate. So if somebody can put on that and have that system working, put my software underneath it, then they just put it on and after they look around for a couple of seconds, it's calibrated itself.